Good day, everyone. Thank you for the opportunity to talk about the issue that is receiving more attention worldwide nowadays. The need to decolonize statutory water law in Africa and to finally recognize the customary commons at equal legal status. In this presentation, I will first unravel customary water law, or living informal law, or as increasingly called in global debates, community-based water tenure. Second, I will touch upon the colonial roots of permit systems. 4 or 5 African countries have this system as their formal administrative water law. And it means that any water user that uses water above a certain threshold, say irrigating more than 1 hectare, is supposed to apply for a permit from national water authorities. And permit systems keep totally overriding community-based water tenure. And lastly, I will talk about one of the ways to decolonize permit systems, hybrid water law. So starting with the customary commons in community-based water tenure, the citation from the Boran captures how water resources are seen as the commons. Water is either a source that you share in as member of a descent-based collectivity, or one that you share out to signify respect. This notion of water resources as the commons, as a resource given by God and to be shared by all, is found across sub-Saharan Africa. And this picture of community-based water tenure is the complexity that rural communities manage as a matter of daily life. It's like the blinking of an eye, I once heard. There are the multiple uses. People depend in many ways on water, so they use it for domestic and a range of productive and cultural uses. And the COVID crisis has only underscored the need for water for domestic uses and hygiene, besides productive water uses that contribute to nutrition, food security, and income. There are also multiple sources to meet these needs. People use and reuse water directly from rain, for example in their fields and forests, and from surface ponds or streams, or in wetlands, and increasingly also from groundwater. Natural water resource availability keeps determining rural livelihoods. Pastoralists, for example, keep moving to water. Similarly, other communities also have lived with seasonal and annual weather and climate variability since time immemorial. And unfortunately, they will have to adjust even more under climate change. And lastly, on infrastructure, society's primary way to deal with climate variability is infrastructure. Infrastructure avoids having to move to water, but makes the water move to the people. It protects against too much water. And last but not least, it stores water in the wet season for use in the dry season. Water storage and conveyance increase the pie of water available to all, if you can afford. And in most parts of Africa, the main problem is not the lack of water resources, but the lack of capital to store and convey water or lift groundwater. Obviously, when one invests in infrastructure, one does so to meet as many needs as possible. So most infrastructure in community-based water tenure is multipurpose. And as this picture of solar-powered technology shows, community-based water tenure is dynamic. The scale of investments in water infrastructure for self-supply is way beyond any state-initiated water infrastructure nowadays in Africa. Growing populations, new market opportunities, and especially new technologies and energy sources support this development to reduce labor burdens and bring health and wealth year-round. To illustrate just a bit further how water is shared during the dry season in community-based water tenure, these are the sets of sharing principles we find in literature. These principles are invoked in each local situation to negotiate that this water now, here, is a bit more mine than yours. The first principle is socio-territorial, and this refers to the link between land and water. This stream flows through my village, so it is a bit more mine than yours. As customary land tenure is widely recognized, this link is extremely important to raise awareness on community-based water tenure as well. And as the Environmental Law Institute is analyzing, statutory land legislation may recognize this link and hence contradict permit systems. The second important principle is that people who make all efforts to construct, operate and maintain water infrastructure can definitely say that this particular water stored or conveyed is more for them than for others. And this is the principle of hydraulic property rights creation. The other three principles found in literature are the first come, first served, transfers, including kinship, but also sale, and then, last but unfortunately not least, power and violence. And talking about that power nowadays, the current permit systems declare all this living community-based water tenure and its sharing principles as illegal until individual water users have their permits. The very small users are exempted from that obligation, so these users are in a legal limbo in state law on what their formal entitlement is. So moving now to the second point, how did Africa end up with a water law that is so inappropriate and discriminatory? And this is a colonial legacy. Colonial powers introduced permit systems precisely with its aims to dispossess Africans and to stimulate white settlers to invest in water infrastructure to boost the colonial minority economy. So history's most dramatic water grab, at least on paper, for example in this official gazette in Kenya in 1929, is all water resources as declared as being owned by the overseas rulers. This underlying water grab justified the power to then generously grant entitlements to the white minority only. The Tanzanian Water Authority called this entitlement dimension of permits as the cake part of permits. And at the same time, from the beginning onwards, the settlers were also obliged to abide with certain conditions for such use, so as the spear. One condition, for example, was that settlers who planned new infrastructure had to check before any construction whether the infrastructure would affect other settlers. And the latter could object. However, when Africans were to be affected, they just had to be informed. At independence, the new governments just replaced His Majesty, the King of England, by the new independent state. And without much further debate, they extended the obligation to apply for a permit to everyone. As a water authority said, one cannot exclude the majority. But anyhow, water law was not much of a concern. The focus in the new independent developmental state was and still is on investing in public infrastructure. Unfortunately, the neoliberal integrated water resource management discourses since the 1990s revived the colonial permit systems, as the Kenyan Act of 2016. So the administration proficient large-scale users, international or national, basically just have to fill a form to obtain the country's strongest water entitlements. And these continue to be stronger than community-based tenure by the large majority. Anyhow, as soon as the revived permit system started being implemented, it became clear that African water authorities grossly lacked the logistics capacities. And this further underpinned the search for alternatives. In debates with water authorities, the solution of hybrid water law is coming up. In this, the state keeps strong powers, but not as owners, but as custodians of water resources in the public interest. So unlike land tenure legislation, states play more roles in water management. Not only the already mentioned role of public infrastructure development, but states also remain important water regulators in the public interest, for example, to prevent pollution. And states play a role in allocating water during dry seasons or droughts, or in anticipating future water sharing. Inevitably and finally, this puts the distribution of water resources at center stage. Comparing numbers of users with the volumes used, various quantifications show how really very few users take up most of the water volumes. The large majority hardly uses any water, even when those volumes are aggregated. It's again amazing how land distribution is high on the agendas, whereas huge inequalities in water uses keep being silenced. Hybrid water law then maintains permits as a useful regulatory tool, so as a spares to enforce conditions to water use. But now these are targeted where state efforts are needed most. That means to regulate the few large-scale and high-impact, high-risk users. This should prevent any overuse or pollution and may impose other conditions. And then other legal tools are to deal with all other water users. So lastly, hybrid water law is about a suite of tools, as locally appropriate, that recognizes water resources as the commons, as a shared resource, and that finally recognizes and protects customary water tenure that aligns with constitutional requirements. Sharing is about prioritizing. And states are also the duty bearers to prioritize water resources bottom-up. And this implies a top priority for any basic domestic and basic productive water users that contribute to the realization of constitutional rights to water and water for food. In most water legislation, there are such tools nowadays, but they have hardly been operationalized as yet. Also, water law is not harmonized as yet with other natural resource legislation. I hope this presentation sheds some further light on the need to better understand and fully recognize community-based water tenure and to empower communities by operationalizing and harmonizing hybrid water law. Thank you for your kind attention.